That's good.
Welcome to First Baptist Church of Fall River. Good to see folks back. Do we have announcements?
We do. We're also trying to figure out why you're not going to casting, but let's see if I do, and then we'll find out what's going on.
Good morning. Okay, this one's working. We'll figure out why yours is a little. It didn't sound like you were up. Okay, we'll figure that out in a second. My announcement is that amazingly, we are now less than a month from the Newport Navy Choristers. The excitement is already there. I've already sold tickets.
Wow.
Wait, so, Jeff, where would we get these tickets?
Oh, look, I have all sorts of things. I have tickets. I have posters. If you have a place that you can think of that you'd like to advertise, to put it up in a living situation, in a business, wherever, we have posters to put up. And then I have the paper that allows people to either be a patron, so you could donate, and that always comes with tickets by being a patron. It also is the selling advertising space for the program. We have some amazing banks and other folks that support us. But I would love to think of it. If anybody has a new idea, a new company, a little small company that wants a little advertising space, we'd love it. It's always good to get something fresh in there. We're always going to see Bank 5. We're always going to see Bay Coast. They are strong supporters. But it is the season, and you know, you're going to see me every Sunday for a while. But please come see me on any of this so that we can get this going. We're meeting with them on Tuesday. They're coming up. We just want to go over everything. Obviously, we're going to be COVID safe, but we're looking for a wonderful night. Thank you. What else? Oh, we have it right here.
So I'm going
to
take that.
Okay, yeah. And so, yes. Brunel, signally from the back and coming from the front. Deacons, it's an important day for you. You're extending right hand of fellowship. But at the end of the service, if you could go through the pews and pick up the little plastic communion cups, that was a deacon's job. And so maybe that got lost a little bit. But if you pick up around your little space, that will be much appreciated. There's a trash can back by Verdell. They're simple, and we found three today.
Oh, wow. From a month ago.
My. So, yeah, we've been, you know, none of us have been too super thorough, but just deacons or anyone, it most much appreciated. Trying to think, there's nothing else coming up right away. I haven't looked in the bulletin.
Thanksgiving service.
There we go. Keep that until I...
Yeah, I'll keep up. We're multiple micing today. The Council of Churches in Fall River is hosting a joint Thanksgiving service. The poster for it is just outside where we'll go to have our coffee, if you want to write down details, on the other end of the ramp room. But it is Tuesday at 7 p.m. There will be a bell choir. I believe I have a couple of our members going. If you play bells, you don't have to be in our bell choir to join the bell choir for Thanksgiving. Just let us know that you want to come. I think we'll need to bring our own gloves, but otherwise the bells will be provided. So 7 o'clock, the Tuesday before Thanksgiving, and if you need a date, someone with a calendar has to look it up, or we can wait until after church and look at what I posted on the end of the ramp room, but the date isn't in my head. Tuesday before Thanksgiving, 7 p.m., it's an Episcopal church. We'll be celebrating communion together, which is amazing. You have to understand the history of all of these churches. Doesn't lend itself to pastors and priests of different denominations celebrating communion together. So it just makes my heart happy when all of the Christians in the city are getting together to celebrate and share in the Lord's Supper. I love that. So please do set aside the time. I know Thanksgiving week is a busy week. I host people in my own home, and will be trying to do everything I can do ahead of time. Make a cranberry sauce from scratch with maybe some nice oranges in it, and all of the things that can be done 2 days ahead of time, I'll be doing on Tuesday. But I'm going to take my time out to drive into Fall River to join in this service with this community. So please do set that aside time, that time aside. Are there any other announcements? Use the handheld. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts.
My soul longs for the courts of the Lord.
My heart and my flesh sing for joy to the living God.
Happy are those who live in your house, singing your praise.
For a day in your courts is better than a thousand elsewhere.
Happy are those who put their trust in you.
Our opening hymn is Take My Life and Let It Be. It is on page 4 in your bulletin. So we are grateful that we have three new members joining us today. So Lee and Wally and Melissa, if you would come here. I'm going to ask you very difficult questions. Lee, can you come up? Melissa, come. I'm trying to get the deacons on one side and the people on the other. Sorry, we didn't. Can you tell we didn't practice this? So we are so grateful this morning that we have three new members joining us: Melissa Murphy, Lee Wardell, and I'm going to call him Wally Keith because I grew up calling him that when I was knee-high to a grasshopper, but I know he prefers Walter. So forgive me if you hear me call him Wally, but to me, Walter Keith is his dad, and so my brain can't hold on to it, but Walter Keith is the name he goes by, and it's the name I put on the certificate is Walter. Excellent. As we journey together in faith with joy, we welcome new members into this community. We are grateful that they are seeking to serve God and neighbor with us in this community that we love. So we welcome and cherish their unique gifts and their experiences as together we follow the Holy Spirit in transforming this community for the work and the mission of Christ Jesus. So I'm going to ask you a very difficult question. And if you accept, ask that at the end you answer, "I will." Will you commit yourself to seek and serve Christ in this community of faith, to bear witness to the power and love of Jesus Christ in your life, and strive to strengthen the mission of this church through worship, prayer, and the contribution of your time, your talents, and your resources?
Yup, Molly says yup.
And church, I'm going to ask you a very difficult question. Will you support these beloved children of God, holding them in prayer, loving and affirming them, and continuing to contribute your time, your talents, and your resources to the work of God in and through this church? If you would you signify by standing? Praise God. And those who aren't standing, if you're interested in joining the church, come let me know. We'll have you talk to the deacons. Praise God. We have three new members. We are so grateful. Will you pray with me? Lord, we ask your blessing on all of those here. We ask your discernment so that going forward together, we might love each other well, we might serve each other well, and that we might serve you in and through this church and this community that we love and that you love. Bless us all. We ask this in the most precious name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Now, Arlene and the other deacons have something for all of you. Elsie. I'm sorry? Is Elsie joining? She's... I'm sorry? You are also getting the right-handed fellowship. Huh? I did not know you were not a member.
No.
You are a member. She never got the right-handed... Well, I have another book, and I have a certificate for you that says you're a member, and we'll get it from the back. See, this is why I made four. Jeff can attest to... Jeff's going to get them now. Yes. Jeff can attest to me. He said, there are three people, there are four certificates, and there's four books. And I said, I don't know why. I did four. So you have to, I knew, I thought you were a member, which made me confused. Elsie, will you continue to support this community that you love with your prayers and your worship and your time and your talents? So, I would never need to leave you out. We love you. At first I thought, is she on the deacons? I didn't realize she was on the deacons. And this is why there were four. So Jeff is going to get his keys and we'll get a book for you too. So let's start on this side and have Melissa come and we'll have you shake the hand of the deacons who are waiting to.
Thank you.
Turkey red on time.
Turkey red on time.
Turkey red on time.
I did not lie. We got four. I'm going to give these directly to you.
Thank you.
I need to sign this for you, though. I haven't signed. And if you'll...
I don't run that tight of ship, sorry. let us all welcome our new members. Thank you all. Praise God. COVID. I mean, it is a time of COVID, but we couldn't do this in pre-vaccinated COVID times, yeah. So, for those of you who are not members of this church, but who have been worshiping with us, if you are interested in joining, please come talk to me. It's a very difficult conversation that you have to have with the deacons. They will quiz you on, Bible verse. No.
Just kidding.
We're gonna ask you if you have a relationship with God in Christ Jesus, and if you say yes to that question, you can be a member of this church. Amen, church. Verdell has graciously agreed to do the gathering prayer.
Can y'all hear me?
There you go. Yes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I want to tell my Father, just thank and praise you for this day. Let us see this nice day and sun shining and new members from First Baptist Church. Lord, continue to bless us in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you.
Inspirational music from Melissa. Together in prayer to lift up our joys and to lift up our concerns. So I'm going to hand the mic off to Jeff and have him come around and ask you to share where you felt God in your life this week, or where you're seeking God's intercession.
Yep.
Excellent. Let's see. I always like to give people a chance to think of something, so when I come to each of you, every one of you is going to have something, but no. Speak as God stirs you, but I had the honor this year to write the stewardship letter, and I just finished that on yesterday. And I just lift up that writing about this church moves me every single time. It just does. It is a joy to be a part of this church, to have each and every one of you, and how this church is moving and how things are attracted to it, because God is absolutely amidst of it, is a blessing. And that is the joy that I lift up, is this church and all that it can do and all that it does. A joy is that next week we will have the praise band, Kingdom 17 is our praise band next week.
Someone needs to explain the 17.
Oh, I can explain it.
But maybe not right here. Anyway, okay. All right. Anyone else? Yes. All right. So we have the diagnosis for Esther. It is Parkinson's is what's has come upon her. That is a difficult, difficult diagnosis. So our prayers will be surrounding her for sure. I think of our friends at Victory Church still. They'll be coming back to serve, but the death in the family was something that really rocked them. So we want to continue to shower them with love and prayers. We want to be the joy of having children in our sanctuary and well-behaved children. Thank you so much. Verdell. Okay. So we're praying for Verdell's neighbor, Jody, and there was an overdose in the family, and so that is tough news to hear. Resulting in death or just passed away? Do we know the name of the person who died? Jody is the one who died. I'm sorry. I'm not getting it right. Okay, so we pray for her son. Yes. All right, so seven-month-old having a seizure and was rushed from Charlton off to Providence to get a greater level of care. So,
Lindora, what's her name?
Her name? Jalea. And so we are thrilled that you are here. We're thrilled that everyone is here on a daylight savings time hour. Some benefited by being here early. So I managed to get an extra walk in with my hour. So amen. We need prayers. So prayers for our president. Prayers for all those in power that they. This is a tough time. This is a tough time. So and prayer can be. Prayer is a powerful instrument in supporting all those that are making those decisions, and so we do pray for them. We pray for Sue, we pray for Edgar and Claudette, we pray for Betty. I got to talk to Betty on Friday. She's doing fine, but certainly was asking about the concert. So.
And Bob.
Let us pray. Eternal God, our Creator and our breath and our Savior, you are our God, and we are grateful to be your people. We are so grateful for this community and her many ministries. We're grateful for the backpack that came in this morning, the gloves that appeared on my doorstep. We're grateful for all who give that our ministries are of their time and their resources so that our ministries might continue. And we're grateful for new members, some of whom have been actively serving in our ministries for a while, some of whom are brand new. We're grateful that we have so many folks with willing hearts to carry on your work in this community. We lift our eyes up to you. We humbly ask you to accept our prayer and our praise. We ask that you renew our strength and help us to build each other up in faith, in hope, and in love. Help us to use our gifts to further your kingdom, and help us to nurture the gifts of those around us. Help us to see what you would have us do. Use us as your hands and your voice to minister to those who need you. We ask that you help all of your people seek to serve you in every aspect of our lives, private and public, so that we might announce the good news and reflect your kingdom in our daily lives. Father, we lift up to you particularly our president and all of those who are in power, that they might have discernment and wisdom to lead this country in peace, justice, and compassion. We pray for those who are in need. We pray for those who are lonely or grieving. We pray for those who feel lost or overwhelmed. We lift up particularly Judy's family, who lost their mother or their family member this week. We pray that you would comfort them, surround them with love, help them to remember Judy with love and gladness in their heart, even as they grieve her loss. We pray for Esther with her new diagnosis, that you would be with her and be with her family and with the doctors, that they might treat her with skill and compassion. We pray for Leon, that he might have many, many more good days and not very many bad ones. We pray for Claudette, that she might be out of pain and that she might be healed. We pray for Bob and Anne, that they might heal well and come back to us. We pray for Sue Holland, and we lift up to you little Julia, that she might have what she needs, that they might discover what the trouble is and stop it, that she might have a long, healthy, good, joy-filled life, that stretches out before her, and that she might come to know and love you and serve you for decades and decades to come. We pray for all of these, that you would grant them health, Father, physical, mental, and spiritual health. And now in silence, we lift up to you those who have entrusted themselves to our prayers. Father, we offer ourselves into your care, and we open ourselves to your will for us, so that we might truly act as your people, and so that your overwhelming love and mercy might shine through us to the glory of your name. All this we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus the Christ. Amen. And now, as Jesus taught us to pray, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our hymn is Lord, Speak to Me. It is on page 5, which is right before the middle of the bulletin.
Thank you.
I love this community. I told the backpack story last week. I won't tell it again from here. I'll tell it individually to anyone who wants to hear. But today, one of our members brought in a backpack. Thank you, brand new. We still need backpacks, but I'm glad that I have one that I brought in from home, an old one, and I have a bright, shiny new one that I can give out. So this week, if anyone needs a backpack, I have them. To my door was delivered, probably not from a church member. I'm going to guess that a church member would have brought stuff in to the church. I got an Amazon package full of gloves at my home address this week with no note in it. I'm guessing sometimes I post on Facebook that I love this good community and the work that this community does. And someone on my friends list, probably, I'm guessing, or another friend who's not, but you know, someone who knows my home address sent a whole bunch of really nice warm gloves with no note. I sort of sent a general thank you, but so thank you to whomever sent the beautiful gloves. We'll have some warm hands this winter. Love isn't an emotion just that we feel in our hearts. Love is an action that we perform when we see people in need. And so when you know someone needs something and you provide that thing for them, that's a piece of love right there. So I'm grateful for that love. If there's something that you need and you don't have, you let me know. We'll figure out. I mean, if the thing that you tell me you need is a trip to Italy, I'm going to laugh and say, gee, that'd be nice. Take me when you figure out how you're going. But if the thing that you need is a real need, we'll figure it out. No one in this church should be going hungry. No one in this church should be cold in the winter. No one in this community should be going hungry. No one in this community should be cold in the winter. So if you have a need, we'll figure out how to meet it. But I stand up here and say that, and the way that I can answer that prayer for anyone who needs it, and we answer that prayer for a lot of people who need those answers. Every Tuesday, every Thursday, I see people who need something. Not just Tuesdays and Thursdays, but definitely always on a Tuesday and Thursday. So if you have shelter yourself, if you know where your next meal is coming from, if you are not cold when you're at home, but you have a nice warm heat on, or you have blankets that you can put on, then please reach into your pocketbooks or into your wallets and give, so that this church can continue to serve Jesus Christ in Fall River, right here. So will the deacons now come forward? Let us collect our morning tithes and offerings. Envelopes, if you've put anything in those, go to Help for the Holidays, Thanksgiving, to make sure that folks have a Thanksgiving feast to enjoy. Thank you.
share of those blessings, that they and we might be useful for your kingdom. We ask that you bless them and bless us, and do your work in and through us. We ask this in the most precious name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Jeff has signed up to read our scripture this morning.
And if you've heard, as you've heard this one before, this one's a tough one to hear. I'm sure Jamie will lead us through it.
This is the Matthew version of the difficult Mark one we did, yeah.
Yes, so. Reading from Matthew 18, 1 through 9. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" He called a child, whom he put among them, and said, "Truly, I tell you, unless you change and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever becomes humble like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone was fastened around your neck and you were drowned in the depth of the sea. Woe to the world because of stumbling blocks. Occasions for stumbling are bound to come, but woe to the one by whom the stumbling block comes. If your hand or your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life maimed or lame than to have two hands or two feet and to be thrown into the eternal fire. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life with one eye than to have two eyes and to be thrown into the hell of fire." And now reading from Isaiah 58, 6 through 9. "Is not this the fast that I choose? To loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them and not hide yourself from your own kin? Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, 'Here I am.'" Lord, Lord.
So here I am picking difficult passages again. This passage from Matthew, like the one from Mark that we read earlier, is not even part of the Revised Standard Lectionary cycle that the more liturgical churches follow, which is that three-year tour through, 60% of the New Testament and some bits of the Old Testament that provide a structured approach to Bible readings. That lectionary does include Mark's gospel account of the blessing of the children. You get in the Revised Standard Lectionary, "Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." But that's where the lectionary stops. Both Matthew and Mark contain a longer passage with these really difficult sayings. And those aren't part of the modern lectionary. I mean, I get it. These passages are awfully graphic for modern sensibilities. And Matthew mentions hellfire, which is also not a specially comfortable thought for moderately progressive Christians. But I keep throwing these kinds of things in front of you because I think it is really essential that we struggle with the hard parts of our scripture. We looked at Mark's version of the millstone earlier this year, and today we're gonna look at Matthew's. "Woe to the one by whom the stumbling block comes. If your hand or foot causes you to stumble, cut it off and throw it away. If your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life with one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into hellfire. Wow. Hellfire. Whoa. These terrible images. These are very strong images that Jesus uses, and I think he uses them to catch our attention. It's pretty clear that stumbling and causing other people to stumble has real and serious consequences, and Jesus wants us to sit up and pay attention. But we do read this scripture knowing that Jesus is a healer, and he's a restorer of vision, that he proclaims recovery of sight to the blind. Followers of Jesus end up with better vision than they started with, not worse vision. So if we look at Jesus' ministry, he never asks people to hurt themselves. He's not followed by a bunch of disciples limping behind him with pieces cut off. So this is metaphorical, church, but it's a sit up and pay attention. This is the strongest wording I can come up with, sort of metaphorical, right? What does Jesus ask his followers to give up? Not body parts, but he asked them to give up their wealth. Did you, when we sang that first song together, what did we sing? Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. There's a line that says, take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful. Take my lips and let them be filled. Let me sing always only for my king. There are a lot of things that were easy to say. Did you enjoy singing that? But then we got to the line, take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Did you sing that with the same gusto that you sang about the taking my lips and my love and my feet? Did you? No. Be honest, how many of you had a little twinge of, well, I might withhold just a mite? Yeah? Pastor's raising her hand, Lou's raising it, good, there we go, yeah. Everyone kind of twinges when we get to that spot, right? You know, I gave up a bunch to be a pastor. I was working in information technology. I took a half-time job before I went into the ministry because I wanted to see if I could live on the kind of money that ministry pays. And half-time in information technology pays about as well as a full-time pastor in a good church. So I walked away from something, but I still have a house, church, with a shelter over my head, and I still have a full refrigerator. And there are a couple of mites, maybe, that I've withheld somewhere along the way. I give my life is for God, really honest, but there's stuff that's hard to give up. Yeah? Yeah. Jesus doesn't ask us, in reality, to pluck out our eyes. Jesus asks his followers to give up their wealth. And he asks some of them to give up their family obligations. He asks them to give up their sins. And he asks them to put down their swords and give up their military resistance to an oppressive force. He asks us to give up our violence, when it seems like a righteous violence. Jesus doesn't allow that. We need to put our swords down. There are things that are less obvious that Jesus asks us to give up. He asks some people to give up their family fishing enterprise and follow him. There's nothing intrinsically bad about a family fishing enterprise, any more than there's anything intrinsically bad about a hand or an eye or a foot. So there is a fair amount of discernment involved in figuring out how to relinquish and remove a stumbling block. Stumbling blocks are not always things that are in themselves inherently bad. Stumbling blocks are different for different people. Something that causes Jeff to stumble might not be something that causes me to stumble at all, or something that causes me to stumble might not cause Luce to stumble at all. So there's discernment and wisdom in figuring out what our own stumbling blocks are. And it's not about labeling that thing as an evil thing. It's just about realizing what does or does not get in our way of following God's path for us. Sometimes my own stumbling blocks are obvious. Anxiety, depression, anger, things that I'd like to remove from my life entirely. Those are the easier stumbling blocks to remove. I'm going to admit, church, a few weeks ago, I noticed that it seemed like all of my friends were either in France or Italy at the same time. Different friends from different parts of my life. I think it's just because the world is opening back up and people haven't been able to travel for so long all of a sudden, I have a handheld mic, I can move. I'm going to drive loose crazy though. Sorry, I'll try. I think just because the world is opening back up, everyone decided that now is the time when they were going to take that trip to Italy or to France. And so my Facebook feed was filled with pictures of an art exhibition in Rome, of a gondolier trip in Venice on the waters, of my friends eating in cafes in Paris. And my first thought, because I'm a pastor, you know, my first thought was just to be filled with joy, right? No, what was I filled with, church? Jealousy. Absolutely, jealousy. Boom! Why is everybody else in France and Italy when I'm here? Yeah? It wasn't hard to recognize that those feelings of jealousy were rising up. And when I recognized them and I named them, then that helped me to face them. So it didn't take me that long because I've lived a few years of life now. You know, I'll be 23 next week. I've lived a few years of life now and I've gotten to a place where I recognize these negative emotions fairly quickly. When they arise and when you recognize them, you say, there's my old friend jealousy again. When you name it, you rob it of some power. And when you name it, it lets you face the thing and stop telling yourself the stories that caused it to arise, but instead look directly at the thing. And I thought, do I want to walk around feeling jealous all day? It doesn't feel good. It feels terrible. Why do I want this? Like, I'm already not in Italy. No, that's not helpful. Right? You have to stop yourself a couple of times. Here I am sitting in Fall River, or in Norton, in the fall. I'm in New England in the fall, and the leaves are turning yellow and orange and red around me, and the world is beautiful, and there's nothing wrong with where I am. I'm just comparing myself with where other people are. The comparison isn't helpful. And once you realize that you're jealous and you say, I don't want to be jealous, and you reach for gratitude. You reach for gratitude. You reach for whatever joy, whatever beauty, whatever grace, whatever love you can find. And it comes to you and you realize that that's where God is in the present moment, in your actual life, not in some fantasy that you have about, I don't know, going to an art exhibit in Rome with your friend, or being paddled down the canals of Venice. I don't think they're happier than I was once I realized that I was in New England in the fall, and I had on my lap a little dog that I expected was gonna pass on a month ago, who is miraculously still, thank you for all of you who prayed, still with me. And I love my little dog, and I love my home on the lake, and I can see these beautiful colors, and all of a sudden, God's love and beauty and joy come flooding into me with that gratitude that I reached for. I could have spent the day, church, walking around under a gray cloud. My friends are all in Italy and France. And I would have felt terrible. And I probably would have projected that on the people around me so that they felt terrible, even if I was trying not to. And I wouldn't have been bringing anything good into the world. I wouldn't have served anyone walking around with that jealousy. But in recognizing it and naming it and reaching for gratitude. Real gratitude, not some sort of, I woke up this morning and I thank God. No, I woke up this morning. I woke up this morning in this beautiful place and I'm happy. And you find your contentment. You find God and then you're able to walk around with God's spirit. Does that make sense? Yeah. I started for the month of November a gratitude practice. I do this every year. I think I talked to you about it last year. Every November, I make a practice of gratitude. Yeah, it's a good thing to keep going all year round, but I lose my steam. For me, it's nice to have a period of time that I dedicate every year to a gratitude practice. You can take out a pad of paper and use that, or you can have a journal, if you have a journal that you write in, or if you're a social media person, you can put it on your Twitter feed or on your Facebook account. I do it often through social media just because I think friends have seen me do it and now they do it too. So a lot of us now have gratitude practices, and so in November, I can see all my feed gets filled with people saying how grateful they are for various things in their lives. These are not necessarily people who are in Rome or in Venice. These are people who are, you know, single parents of autistic children who have difficult lives sometimes, or who are school teachers in difficult times, or whatever. But they post their gratitude, and I post my gratitude, and we develop this community of people who reach for gratitude in November. And I recommend the practice to you. For the month of November, either on your social media feed or just on a pad of paper or in a journal, write down every single day something you're grateful for. I have a friend who writes gratitude three things every day. Every day she writes three things she's grateful for. I found that's not any harder than reaching for the one thing. On a day when you're having trouble finding gratitude, it's that first bit of gratitude is the hardest one to come, and once you reach for gratitude and you find something you're really grateful for and you write it down, it's not hard to get things two and three. So I recommend this practice to you. It will change your life. If you do this year after year, even 1 month a year, if you every single day, there'll be days when you sit down and it's easy to write your gratitude. I'm so grateful for my community. I'm so grateful for the sun shining on the leaves. I'm so grateful for this and that. And there'll be other days when it's harder to find the gratitude. But I'm telling you, if you develop the spiritual practice of stopping and reaching for God, reaching for gratitude, reaching for love and beauty and joy, you will find it. And that is your way to reconnect with God. So my homework for you, if you should accept it, is a month's worth of, sorry, I was a teacher before I was a pastor. Although I didn't ask them if they would accept it. My homework for you, if you should choose to accept it, is for the whole month of November, grab a piece of paper, or a journal, or your social media feed, and every single day, whether you're happy or sad, coming in to sit down, reach for gratitude and express it in that place. I'm so grateful for my community. I'm so grateful that when I was sad, I thought, well, what can I do? I can reach out and call a friend, and I talked to an old friend that I loved. I'm so grateful that, I was having a day in which I was jealous, and I thought, well, where am I? Oh, my heavens, I'm in New England. New England is beautiful in the fall. I mean, if it had been March, that would have been another story, but October in New England, come on. How can you not be grateful to be here in October with the incredible beauty around us? Yes, some of you might reach for gratitude practice. Yes. How many of you are thinking about, good, excellent. Excellent. Well, that's my goal for you today, to get the gratitude practice. I do want to get back to the scripture and say this one little bit about children, because it talks a lot about becoming like children, humble like children. Children bring us a lot of joy. I remember having a difficult ride up to New Hampshire. I'm an only child, but I'm gonna call my best friend's son, my nephew. His name is Ben, and he is unbelievably driving now. I don't know how that happened. He was like 8 yesterday, but I drive up sometimes to New Hampshire. They come down to see me. They're my Thanksgiving family. I remember driving up a few years ago to see Ben, and I had a difficult drive. There was a lot of traffic, and it was not a pleasant trip. And by the time I got there, I was thinking, why do I do this? You know, I'm gonna have to do this. And why do I make this trip? It's a long trip. It's, you know, don't I have any friends who live closer? I could see them instead. And Ben was at camp, at summer camp, and he didn't know I was coming. And so we go to pick them up, and Ben sees me from the back of the church to the front of the church, all the way across the field. They're coming back from a hike or something at the end before pickup. And Ben's looking for his mom, and next to his mom, he sees me. And he screams, "Aunt Jamie!" and runs from the back of the church to the front of the church to jump into my arms and give me this gigantic hug. And I thought, oh, that's why I drive up here. That's why I drive up here. That's all I needed, that one flying monkey hug was the thing that filled me for the rest of the day, and honestly still fills me remembering it. Ben is, as I said, he's driving now. He's a teenager. They'll come to visit me, and sometimes he's, you know, embedded in his phone. Before he leaves, though, he always... Did I lose it? Before he leaves, though, he always... I don't need it. Before he leaves, he always turns around with intention and gives me a real, not a perfunctory little hug, but a real, I'm so glad you're in my life sort of hug. Children don't have love as a concept in their head or an idea of fluttering in their heart. Children have this very physical idea of love, right? I love this person, therefore I'm going to climb on them. That's a child's version of love. Children, when they think, they don't like to think in abstract thoughts. They don't like to think about love or peace or compassion or whatever as some sort of idea in their head. Children like to think about how beautiful the swan is, how warm and fluffy the dog is. They like to think in concrete terms, things that can be touched, things that can be given, things that can be accepted. That's how children think. So when God says to us, enter the world like a child, I think he means that we should enter the world understanding that we should interact with each other in tangible, concrete ways that actually make a difference in people's lives. If they're hungry, feed them. If they're cold, give them a blanket or put clothes on their back. If they're lonely, ask if it's okay. We're in a time of COVID. And then give them a hug, show up in their lives, give them a phone call, be for them, not just an I'm thinking about you sort of distant thought, but a real concrete presence in their lives. I think that's the difference between interacting with the world as an adult and interacting with the world as a child. There's one other difference. As an adult, I like to think that I take care of myself, right? I go to work, I bring money home, I buy my own food, pay my own property tax and excise tax and water bill. And I could stand here listing things for quite a while, right? We love our children. Can they support themselves? Do they bring enough into your household to justify their if you had a roommate, you would want your roommate to bring in enough money to cover his or her share of the heat, his or her share of the water bill, his or her share of the rent. Are children ever in a year going to be able to bring in
the amount of money that we spend on them for food, for diapers, for heat, for all of those kinds of things. Any of you ever had a child that managed to pay its own way? No, right? And in God's kingdom, I believe we are like children. Church, we can't possibly pay our own way. We can't do it. But God loves us wholeheartedly anyway, the way we love our children. It's no mistake that God allows us to call God Father, right? We are God's beloved children who cannot possibly earn our own keep, but who are learning and growing in faith in the family of God. So let us enter the world as children, loving each other in concrete ways, understanding that we cannot possibly earn our keep, but that our keep is already provided for us. Our sin is already forgiven. The love and the grace and the joy are already freely there. So let us enter the world with love and thanksgiving and grace. Amen, church.
Amen.
Christian love,
remembering one another in prayer, sharing each other's joys, and sustaining each other in time of difficulty.
We will faithfully meet together to promote the spiritual life of our church and ourselves through the worship, the privilege of prayer, and study of the scriptures. We will strive to strengthen the mission of the church by contributing our time, our talents, and our resources. We pledge ourselves to bear witness to the power and love of Jesus Christ in our lives and to aid in proclaiming the gospel here and throughout the world. We will be faithful to educate ourselves and our children in the knowledge and love of God so that the Holy Spirit may be seen in all of our relationships and so that we may live to the glory of Him who has called us out of darkness into His marvelous light.
Practice open communion here at First Baptist Church, by which I mean if you have a relationship with God in Christ Jesus, or if you are seeking a relationship with God in Christ Jesus, you are welcome
at this table. Will you pray with me? Radiant God, in the first moment of creation, you spoke and the light of creation dispelled the thick darkness of chaos as the dust of the earth was shaped into your image as you breathed life into us. We could have lived in grace and peace with you for as long as the sun endures, but we were tempted to sin, and we were ashamed and overwhelmed with the desire to hide ourselves. Lord, you sent us prophets to tell of your light and your love, but we listened to the world's songs of power and pride. And when we were stumbling in darkness and righteousness did not reach us, and justice was far from us, you sent Jesus, who left the glory of heaven to bear the consequences of our sin, so that we could be set free. Our offenses are ever before us, and we acknowledge our sins, and so we are grateful that you have redeemed us. So we do in this place what you did in an upstairs room. Most holy God, send your spirit upon those gathered around this table and on the gifts of the bread and the cup, that they might become for us your body, healing us, filling us, making us whole, and that we might become for you your body, reflections of your light and love until your kingdom comes. Amen. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took the bread, and after he blessed it, he broke it, saying, "This is my body broken for you. As oft as ye eat of it, do this in remembrance." The bread of heaven, eat and be filled. Likewise, after the meal, we are told that Jesus took the wine, and after he blessed it, he poured it out for them, saying, "This is the new covenant, poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. As oft as ye drink of this, do this in remembrance of me." The cup of salvation, drink and never be thirsty.
After having just received communion, may the peace, contentment, and show of your love shine upon us. May we shine it upon all those around us. Amen.
Amen.
Will you stand and join in the final hymn, which is sent forth by God's blessing?
Thanksgiving.
Amen.
Amen.
All right.
Go forth now in love. Go forth now in gratitude. Go forth now in peace and in joy. Go forth in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.